Hello my friends, Mina Geek here. In September, it's been exactly 20 years since the amazing Atron 64 was launched. But were the first Atron 64s really that fast compared to the mighty Pentium 4? Let's find out by running 50 tests of performance. This is the CPU, and at the first glance we see that AMD means business. On the left we have their older CPU, the Atron XP, with the die exposed. But now the Atron 64 has a nice integrated heat spreader, which means that it's way less prone to chipping, and in theory it should be better for cooling the CPU. This is an Atron 64 3200 Plus, clocked at 2.2 GHz, compatible with socket 754, so the first desktop socket for Atron 64. The release price was around $278. There are a lot of improvements that AMD did from the Atron XP to the Atron 64, but the more notable ones are the integrated memory controller, meaning that the CPU communicates directly with the RAM, the 64-bit support, which at that time meant that you could use more than 3.2 GB of RAM, and new SSC instructions. The downside of this CPU's integrated controller is that it's only single channel, so you won't have dual channel memory when using Atron 64, and it supports only 2 sticks of RAM memory. The CPU will be used together with an M4 3 motherboard, 1 GB of DDR400MHz memory, single channel. On the other hand, we have the much maligned, often scorned, heat generating Pentium 4 Prescott. Yes sir, Pentium 4 Prescott clocked at 3.2 GHz on socket 478. We're going exotic. The release price for the Pentium 4 was around $278, the same price as the Atron 64. Gone were the days when you bought AMD because it was cheaper than Intel. The motherboard is another ASRock with the almighty Intel 865 chipset with 800 FSB support and DDR400MHz dual channel capabilities. The video card I'll be using is an AGP GeForce 6800GS with 512 MB of video memory and the operation system a Windows XP Service Pack 2 32-bit. Let's begin the tests with Unreal. Yes, that Unreal from 1998, but with a twist. We're going to use the software renderer, so the game will run only using the CPU power. You can't go more retro than playing in software mode. And the power goes to the Pentium 4, which is faster, at least on the lower resolution. Not bad for a slow and heavy CPU. 10 more FPS for the 1% lows is quite impressive. You can really feel the difference in the heat of the battle. Moving to 1024x768, both CPUs start to shake a little bit, but the Pentium 4 still manages to get over 30 FPS for the 1% lows. With 15 FPS more than the Atron 64 for the average FPS, this round goes to the Pentium 4. Gothic 1 is not the best game for benchmarking, that's why it's one of the games that needs to be benchmarked. We need to see the oddities. On 640x480, the Atron is a little faster on average FPS, but the differences are not considerable, while the 1% lows are identical. Also, you must appreciate the 20% view distance. It looks like the sequel to Journey into the Unknown. Going to 1024x768, we have a similar situation. Notable here is the 10% difference for the 1% lows in favor of the Atron 64. I'm using this opportunity to show why Gothic 1 is regarded as not optimized. We have a lot of FPS spikes, as you can see right now. And these spikes make me uncomfortable, they make the game feel bad. But this is because the game has zero loading screens, from the first second to the last. Neither Morrowind, Oblivion or Skyrim can do this. Take that, Bethesda! The entire game is loaded as you play, hence the stutters. This stutter right here happened because the game loaded the city. I consider this a draw, as the only real differences are for the 1% lows at high settings, and this might be attributed to faulty testing or just strange game engine behavior. Seriously, the second encounter is the same on both CPUs, maybe 1-2 FPS differences from time to time in favor of the Atron 64. No differences for the 1% lows and minor differences for the average FPS. Moving to 1280x1024 high settings, the situation stays the same. The differences are inside the margin of error. The only problem I have is with the crazy FPS ups and downs. and in Serious Sam we have some serious, no pun intended, FPS spikes. So the average FPS of 98 is a little bit misleading. After removing the huge FPS spikes, we have a new average, 79 FPS. And so, for the first time in history, I will introduce a new component in benchmarking, the average combat FPS, which is the only FPS you'll ever need. But again, draw. A little nice game with little nice cars, the Poor Man's Revolt RC Cars was released in 2003. The nice thing about this game is that it has a built-in demo, so it's really good for testing stuff, as you'll always get the same results. In this game, we see zero differences, even when we're looking at the live FPS. This is true for both resolutions and settings. But look at how smooth the FPS is. Perfection. This game results in a big draw. I've used the excellent in-game benchmark for X2 The Threat, and here the Athlon 64 is just a tiny little faster, but we're talking Formula 1 differences here. Moving to higher settings, the Pentium 4 is faster. The strange thing here is that during combat scenes, the Athlon 64 seems faster, so I think that we just have to trust the in-game benchmark results. Let's call this a draw. Far Cry is the next game, but before moving to the tests, I wanted to thank our today's sponsor, Abit, the leading manufacturer of high-end enthusiast and gaming motherboards. Over the years, Abit proved themselves...
But geek, Abit went bankrupt 2 decades ago.
Oh no! Well, DFI were better anyway, let's move on. So, Far Cry. The game loads faster on the Athlon 64 by 2 seconds. Now, this is a test I've been eager to do. My life is complete now. Surprisingly, Far Cry is faster on the Pentium 4, especially the 1% lows. We have 8 FPS more on Intel. Good job! Moving to a higher resolution, the results are similar. No major differences here. I was expecting bigger performance drops from the lower to the higher resolution. But here we are. The video card does its job well, as both the CPUs. This round goes to the Pentium 4, for the 1% lows differences. Leave a comment if you disagree. Oblivion loading speed is identical between the two CPUs. But what about the performance? Well, at 640x480 you have no differences. There are big differences between the average FPS and 1% lows for each CPU. But it's to be expected, just like in Gothic 1's case, Oblivion has dynamic loading for the map and assets. Fraps benchmarking can be iffy, if done incorrectly. That's why we need to see some in-game benchmarks for 100% accuracy. Quake 2 benchmarks were done using the software renderer, just like Unreal. 16% differences when using 640x480, although here we have over 100 FPS for both CPUs. Moving to 1024x768, the Pentium 4 gets a 25% lead, which is not a small feat. Finally, we have 15% at 1280x960, and here the Athlon 64 is not able to keep a smooth gameplay. 45 FPS for Quake 2 is not enough. Pentium 4 is the winner here. In Quake 3 we don't have big differences also. We have around 300 FPS for all tests, so nothing to comment here. This should be a draw. In Painkiller on the other hand we have some strange results. I guess that both CPUs are a bottlenecking factor for the video card. Otherwise I don't understand the similar FPS across all resolutions and settings. Maybe I will be removing Painkiller from my tests, it doesn't seem that reliable. But the Athlon 64 wins the round. Fear is a very demanding game, but still the Pentium 4 has a slight lead at the low settings. Moving to the higher settings, both CPUs have the same performance. Fear results in a draw. And the results are in, ladies and gentlemen, and the winner is the Pentium 4. These are all the games. Negative is advantage for the Pentium 4, positive for the Athlon 64, it's time to release the flames. What about the power consumption? My current tests were basic. If you want or need further tests, hit me up. At idle, the entire Pentium system takes around 113 watts. The Athlon 64 system with Cool and Quiet enabled, the option that reduces the CPU multiplier when idle, and hence the frequency, has around 82 watts. Without Cool and Quiet, the AMD system has around 104 watts, just 9 watts lower than the Pentium 4. At full load while running Cinebench, the Pentium 4 system draws a hefty 185 watts, while the Athlon 64 just 135 watts, 50 watts less. The consumption grows by 50 watts for the Athlon 64 when running 3DMark 2001 SE, while the Pentium 4 increases by 10 watts only. Still, the Pentium 4 draws 20 watts more than the Athlon 64. If you have a retro system, you're going to install GOG games for sure. The Athlon 64 is a lot faster here, 23 seconds faster more precisely. Install a bigger game, the differences are going to be even bigger. By copying a 2.5 GB file, we see that the Athlon 64 is again faster, but not by much, only 11 seconds. Copy the entire Lord of the Rings DVD series, and on the Athlon 64 you get to see the epic intro while the Pentium 4 is still copying. The Pentium 4 has hyper-threading, meaning that applications that are optimized for multi-threading are going to run better than on the Athlon 64. Looking at the CPU usage, I can't tell if 7-Zip is optimized for multi-threading or not, but the Pentium 4 is faster. Pentium 4 is again faster when decompressing the same folder, by 6 seconds, but not a big deal. And now, for the first time in history, the first ever results based on estimates. Yes, sir, if you think that I will be killing these nice CPUs for an hour, you are out of your minds. The estimates show that the Pentium 4 is faster in Handbrake. Old parts are more precious than some charts. Let's continue. And now, for some synthetic benchmarks. In 3DMark 99, we have similar results. In 2001 SE, the Pentium 4 is faster, and the same can be said about 3DMark 03. But these results were obtained with the Athlon 64 RAM running at 333 MHz. Using 400 MHz, we have these results. The Athlon climbs the ladder and has a way higher score in 3DMark 99, but similar scores in 2001 SE and 03. RAM speed is important, of course, but it's not my fault that the motherboard was unable to run at the full 400 MHz that the memory module supported. That's on Nvidia's MForce 3 chipset or on ASRock's implementation of it. In Cinebench, the Pentium 4 has a better score, mainly because both threads are working at 100% capacity, so the hyper-threading does its job well. After all, the only advantage that Pentium 4 had over the Athlon 64 back then was hyper-threading, at least in supported software. Games sometimes ran worse with hyper-threading enabled. In Super P, the Pentium 4 is faster. That's it. I know it's not interesting, but I recorded the benchmark, so here it is. And now, in the most useless benchmark ever invented by human beings, we have this. Enjoy! Oh, and all the tests, besides games and 3DMark, were done with memory speeds of 333 MHz for the Athlon 64. That's on me. Thank you all for watching, and until next time, leave fanboyism behind and be nostalgic.